Welcome everyone to the video. I will do my best to be on point here as we go over sort of a potpourri of pointers. We start out the video with the confession that I have a severe continuity problem. I confess to myself and to everybody else, I have a very extremely severe continuity problem, and that causes me to be a fool, be played for a fool by whimsicality. And we are working here on this video on our severe continuity problem. It's the only problem we have. All other tendencies of delay, all tendencies of delay have their roots in the continuity problem. They're rooted in it. Consider it like a hydroponic solution, and everything has roots in this hydroponic solution. Well, if we pour out this hydroponic solution, everything will no longer get what it needs, right? So all these complexes, the tendencies of delay, are rooted in our continuity problem, our continuity fear, which is the fear of a sudden, abrupt change of experiencing from one experience to another, where the one we change into experiencing has no relation to the one that came before. So just this abrupt, sudden, totally different. We want it smooth, some continuity to our transition, okay? So God knows we have this problem. We know we have it. We admit it. We confess it. That places us in the right context for getting free of our foolishness, because really truth is very simple, and we just stumble trying to understand it because of our fear. Say, I don't want to understand it too well because I'm afraid of a continuity issue. So we'll get half of it and be confused about the other half, and then the whole thing, it becomes irrelevant at that point. So we're going to make some headway here with this continuity problem. The resolution to the continuity problem is the vision of oneness. We say the vision of oneness is there for me. The vision of oneness is mine to see. The vision of oneness is totally free. The vision of oneness is mine to keep. The vision of oneness wakes me from my sleep. We're in a deep, deep coma. A deep, deep coma. I had an experience last night, this dream, where I realized I have been in this coma for a long time. And I caught what put me into it in the dream. So this is very important. Let us look at that. What is it that put me into a coma? Specialness. A special place. A special place. The belief that, for me, it was, in the dream at least, it was, I went into like a swoon, like a trance-like swoon, which is not a good thing. You don't really know where you are or what you're doing. You just kind of go into this a trance-like condition. We don't want a trance-like condition. Those are to be avoided at all costs, because you're just drifting without any awareness of where you are, or and you can go into a very bad situation. So I thought that I came across, I was in this metaphysical library, and sort of the world of metaphysics, you might say. There were little discussion groups, book groups, the ladies were chatting, and they took me to some place in this library, and there was a little sign there of all these books, metaphysical books, and it said, right here, this very spot in this library was where, and it used a couple of gurus, I think it was something like saying, this is where Yogananda wrote about Anandamayi Ma, or something like that. Wrote her a letter about her. And I said, are you kidding me? I said, I mean, this is the exact spot where this took place? And they said, yes, exactly right here. And I suddenly went into this sort of like trance state. I said, swooned into this trance state, like I was just floating. And what I saw was, I kept floating and kept floating and kept floating. And I turned upside down, actually. It was upside down. And I just floated through life in this trance-like state, being unaware of what was going on, in like in a coma. I went into it like a coma. because it's like the specialness of this place. I was overcome with some kind of spiritual emotion about that. Let me bump this up a little bit. Now, this is not a good thing, actually. It is not a good thing at all. So, I caught it, though. In the dream, I was sort of looking at what's going on, and I was aware of this is how I went into this trance-like state of spiritual emotion. We're not looking for a trance-like state based on spiritual emotion. No. It's different. The vision of oneness is quite different than that. Quite different. It's an awareness. It's an awareness of everything. You're aware that God is with everything. In my trance state, I wasn't aware of anything. I was wrapped up in my own body feeling of emotion, spiritual emotion, of specialness. And I wasn't aware of anything else at all. That is not good. It was a setup, of course. I set myself up. We all set ourselves up. Amazing that we think that there's a special places. For instance, maybe the mountaintop where Jesus ascended from. We get there and someone says, this is the exact spot where Jesus stood when he ascended up into the clouds of heaven. And people would be swoon and go into religious emotion and just... They feel like they leave their body, they're drifting in space, and they're just unaware of anything, just, you know, swooning in religious emotion. That is to be avoided at all costs. Now, so we need to practice this. I need to come out of this state I've been in. It's a very bad state I've been in. But we think it's good because it's based on religious emotion. But it's not. It's not. So when we come across a special place, we can say, this place, along with all other places, is totally saturated with God's grace. This place, along with all other places, is bathed in God's lovely light of remembrance. This place, along with all other places, has the light of God's beauty resting upon it. This place, along with every other place, has the blessed name of God upon it. Okay, this place, along with every other place. So this is how you have to counter it. I'm thinking, I'm trying to bring myself back in time. What could I have done to keep myself from going into that swoon? They said, well, this is the very spot. I said, you know, and I said, well, I could have said, this spot, along with every other spot, is totally immersed in God's grace. See, then I could have looked at this spot, another spot, and said, okay, yeah, all of it is. You know, this spot, along with every other spot. You don't deny that the grace is there. If there's some place where you think something special happened, something religious, spiritual, great, historic, whatever. You say, okay, this spot, along with every other spot. You always bring it back to the vision of oneness. You always bring it back to the vision of oneness. So these continuity practice that we're doing is all about bringing it back to the vision of oneness. And you will find yourself coming home. You will find yourself being aware of how you got lost in the first place. That's what happened in this dream. I'm having these dreams where I'm coming home, as it were, waking up, coming out of trance, coming out of coma. So this place, or this thing, you get a relic and someone says, these are the flowers. This is the flowers that Anandamayi Ma wore in this great moment, you know. And these are actual flowers, and you put them on and you're just like, you know, to swoon in or whatever, you know, you could say the same thing. This is the robe that Jesus wore. Or you find relics, and this is the very robe, and you say, oh my gosh, the robe. Well, don't deny it. Just say, oh my gosh, this thing, this object, along with every other object, is totally bathed in God's lovely living light of remembrance. Wow. Yeah, this robe, along with everything else there is, without exception, is totally bathed in the light of God's lovely living light of remembrance. This flower necklace, these sandals that were worn by the great guru, oh, these sandals, yes, these sandals, along with everything else in the universe, is totally immersed in the lovely living light of God's remembrance. Yes, these sandals along with everything else. Okay, you see where I'm going with this. And I'm telling you, coming out of this coma, this trance state that we're in, is essential. We have to do it. And so these pointers are, as I see it, you know, how to do it, how to break the spell. We're under the spell. Now, why are we under the spell? I've talked about that at length. But let's keep practicing right now this technique. So is a place or a thing or a thought? Or we come across, what do we come across? This is the place where someone was enlightened. Enlightenment, right on this spot, you say. This is the Buddha. Was it Bodhi Gaya or something under the Bodhi tree? It's at this spot, and you're right there, and you say, oh, you start shaking and trembling, and you're carried away with religious emotion. And this very spot is where the Buddha, you know, thousands of years ago, attained liberation under this tree. Okay, so you say, oh my God, this is the spot. This very spot, along with every other spot in the universe, is totally bathed in God's lovely living light of remembrance of reality. This very spot, along with every other spot, is it. This spot and every other spot is it. So you center your religious emotion in the continuity problem and the vision of oneness, and you stay centered. And so you don't get carried away. I don't feel like I'm being carried away. You don't get carried away. Because what is it that reminds us of reality, that solves the continuity problem? Seeing everything equally included in the loveliness, the beauty, the identity, the oneness. Everything equally. No exceptions, no judgment. Everything equally. It's totally seamless, totally smooth. All-inclusive, everywhereness. That is what reminds us. Nothing else. Nothing else reminds us. If there's one exception, it does not remind us of reality. If there's more somewhere than somewhere else, it doesn't remind us of reality. It reminds us of delusion, mirage, and lies, deception, denial, projection. So as soon as we say that there's more grace someplace than somewhere else, we swoon into a state of coma, of forgetfulness, actually. So religious romanticism is the great pit, you know, that you fall into. And certainly I was a religious romantic. I was in the tradition of romanticism in Europe, the romantic tradition of culture, and so I must have carried that into this life, and I was very spiritually romantic. So the idea of coming upon the very place or somewhere, something, you know, where Buddha attained enlightenment, I feel like I would just fall to pieces. No. Now let's say you meet a guru, you say this one. Or saint, okay, if you want to use whatever term you want to use for a holy person, someone's holiness. You say, this person, this dear spirit, along with all other spirits, is totally immersed in the eternal, God's eternal light of remembrance, God's lovely eternal light of remembrance. This holy guru, this holy saint is, along with everyone else, is totally bathed in God's eternal lovely light of remembrance. And you see how that keeps you centered out of a religious emotion? It keeps you centered in truth, in fact, in oriented towards the vision of oneness. You could say this dearly beloved saint, Rinpoche, Lama, Guru, Rabbi, all sorts of different terminologies you can use from whatever tradition. This dearly beloved holy one, along with all dearly beloved holy ones, without exception, which is everyone, along with everyone, has the God's lovely, beautiful, eternal light of remembrance resting upon them. How wonderful is that? So you're not denying that there's something wonderful, but you're putting it in the essential context that is absolutely necessary. And it is more important to focus on this practice than it is to explain just how terrible it is to fall under the spell. Because then you start working for externalization, really. And that's a nasty thing. You become enslaved to this whole idea that there's something wonderful externally that is going to remind you something, some beautiful idol that is going to remind you of reality. And so you become enslaved to trying to produce something super beautiful externally in the world, whether it's a beautiful person, a beautiful estate, a beautiful garden, a beautiful world, beautiful universe, whatever. Something external, external, external to what you are. Now, the problem with the question we all have to ask ourselves is, can we ever be truly happy with something we believe is external to us, external to us? Will we not always feel insecure about that? No matter how beautiful we think it is, it's external to us. It's not internal. It doesn't belong to us. It's not one with us. It's external. So how can we ever feel secure with anything external, no matter what it seems to be? Here's another question. Everywhereness. Is there anything external to everywhereness? Is there anything external to everywhereness? Well, if there isn't, then we must not be external to everywhereness either, right? And there must not be anything external to everywhereness. Right now. We don't need time to make that so. It must be so right now. Nothing external to it. So the belief that there's something external to us must be a delusion. Only appearances can appear to be external to one another, right? Only appearances. One appearance can seem to be external to another appearance. But can either of those appearances be external to everywhereness? So the whole notion that there's something external to us, we need to externalize something, it must be crazy. It must be delusional. And so when we're working on, people are so scared of the continuity fear that they want to get some things, they want to solve this fear by getting external things that they think that it's not internal. They're afraid of the internal realization of everywhereness. It's internal, it's everywhere. There's no place that's not internal. You can't even speak of internal because there's no external. So We're so afraid of that. We're desperate to remain attached to externals. So you have this mindset in the world of a unquestioned total orientation to externals and a desperate attempt to remain attached to externals, which means to try to beautify the world as much as possible. And what I find is people will try to bring about a trance state in you, a religious trance state, where at that point you actually become like a slave to them, because you're really not aware. You become dependent on them because you're in this trance-like condition. You're not really sure what you're doing. And then they use you to say, look, here, work on making me beautiful, making my life beautiful, because they are completely obsessed with remaining attached to what they see as external appearances. So they don't turn within and realize the oneness, that is there, because they feel it's totally continuity break there. So what happened to me is what happens to so many people, is you end up working for idols. You work for beautifying something external, trying to beautify the external to the exclusion of the internal. Now, I'm not saying that you're supposed to make the external ugly or non-attractive. We're not trying to do that, because we're still working on externals then, right? Same thing. We're working on externals, trying to change externals. Whether we're trying to make them beautiful or trying to make them ugly, we're still working on externals. So a minimum of effort towards externals is what we're after, and a maximum of effort towards right spiritual practice, which is to say, if you come across a very beautiful external, which you can actually unexpectedly, which happened to me yesterday, actually, you can come across something external which is just stunningly, amazingly beautiful. You say, this appearance, along with every other appearance now and that could possibly arise, it as it is totally immersed and bathed in God's lovely, beautiful, living light of remembrance that is the vision of oneness that resolves the continuity problem for me, that is the only value there is. Praise God, thank you, God, for the vision of oneness. One second. There is a UPS trip. Let me see. I want to check something on that UPS truck. Just a second. Okay. As I thought, they have repainted their trucks. They used to have like a kind of a semi-globe on there. Let me get this going here. A half globe on there. Truck and worldwide service it says on, but now they just says worldwide service on it. Okay, UPS upside what down? Okay, then there's a lot of stuff taking place right now in the world. It is quite concerning. Anyway, we have to come out of our trance state. When you come across these externals, you have to have a technique to remain centered. And we have the technique. This is what we're working on. So, we come across something, oh my gosh, it's like, wow, designed to invoke religious emotion. You don't want that. You want the vision of oneness. So you say, this place, along with every other place in the entire universe, is so wonderfully touched by God's beautiful, lovely, eternal living light of remembrance. Thank you, God, for the vision of oneness. Thank you for the vision of oneness. Thank you for resolving my terrible continuity problem by showing me that everything is equally immersed and touched with by this lovely living light of remembrance. That everything, how wonderful it is. You see, you don't let yourself get trapped into that state of religious emotion, which gets exploited by those who are obsessed with remaining attached to external appearance. If there's something external to you, you must be external to it, right? there's an inside outside to reality is what you're saying. Is there some in everywhereness? Is there an inside to everywhereness? Does he say, you know what? I entered into the inside of everywhereness. is there an outside of everywhereness? If there's no outside of everywhereness, omnipresence, how could there be an inside? But when we say this is an external appearance to me, it means it's outside of me. That must mean there's an inside and an outside to me. And I'm outside to the appearance too. It's duality. So this world is completely fanatical about attachment to external appearances. And it is desperate. The desperation comes from only one source, the fear, continuity fear. Once we start pinpointing this is the problem, it really enables us to get free of our coma. There's no longer any like thinking like, wow, why are people so crazy? Why are they acting this way? It's the continuity fear, no other fear. It's the everything has its roots in the continuity fear. They said they don't want to succeed. They're too afraid to succeed. Even though the way is easy, they say, oh, no, I don't want to succeed. I'm too afraid. I might succeed too well. You know, I might wake up too fast. I don't want to do that. Now I want to go deeper into sleep so I don't wake up too fast. That's what's happening. So attachment to externals, fixations on beautiful things. And you see it. You see people. It's just like, holy cow. They want to make themselves as beautiful as possible, as much, you know, just like, and they want to have everything as beautiful as possible, and they're more than willing to get everybody they possibly can to help them with that, to help them with that. If they have the money, if they have the leverage, whatever. Excuse me. They want you working for them. Bottom line, they want you to work for them to make their lives beautiful, external lives beautiful. Even if that means spending your life taking out their garbage, rotting refuse, and cutting tree branches down and sweeping up leaves for your entire life, they will feel, oh, that's what you're supposed to do. Yeah, you're helping making my life more beautiful, my external appearance, make it more beautiful. That's saving me. They think that's salvation. So if you tell them, yeah, I'm here to help you with your salvation, they say, great. Great, great. Look, I got a whole bunch of garbage back there, like 10 years worth of garbage. And so if you can just take that out for me, that would be great. That would really help my salvation. It's like that. And nobody says anything. So because everybody's that way here. That has nothing to do with salvation. That only thing makes things worse. I say, take out your own. You should take out your own garbage, you know. If you want to change the appearance of everything, do it yourself. Don't involve me. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Those who are here to help with salvation should have no role in sweeping up leaves and stuff. That's the realm of appearances. That's the realm of those who want that. That's their responsibility, not somebody who's here to free them from that. It's not their responsibility at all to care for this world. Not in this life to care for external appearances, to make them look beautiful. It's not their responsibility at all. So for me, I got, through religious emotion, I got trapped into basically spending my entire life doing the worst type of work, trying to, you know, the stuff that is ugliest, get rid of this stuff, it's really ugly, get rid of this, I don't like this, this is ugly. And so I said, oh, I'm serving their salvation, I gotta do this. Otherwise, I would lose this religious emotion, this feeling of religious emotion that I have. So ended up just, you know, someone says, look at this horrible spill, this toxic spill or something. It's me the ones that have to clean it up. Oh, look at this, so awful. This is just causing me to feel so terrible about, so nervous about external appearances. I don't feel so attached to them. But you gotta take this for me, take this out. And, you know, this dead stuff here, this rotting stuff that's so ugly there. Oh, this dead tree, take it out, do this. My entire life. Sweep up the leaves, clean up the leaves. Oh, the wind, mess things up, clean things up so it looks, you know, that's all I've done my entire life. Completely unfulfilling. Hideous. And I'm trying to figure out what in the world is wrong. Well, they threaten you with loss of religious emotion. This religious trance, if you don't do what they tell you to do. If you don't do what they tell you to do. So, if you're not afraid of losing that religious emotion, you can break the spell, can't you? Which is, I need to do that. We all do. So, in my dream, for example, there's ladies that were doing, happened to be there, but it could be men too. This whole issue of attachment to external appearances is something that everybody suffers from to various extents. And went into this religious trance, religious emotion, saying, oh, this is the very place where Yogananda wrote about Anandamayi or something like that. It could be anything, right? And I went into this trance. I thought I was like in ecstasy or something. And I've remained in it for the longest time. Now they could be whispering to me, says, hey, you know, and I've been serving them the whole notion of cleaning stuff up for women, in other words. Oh, this is such a mess. Can you spend a couple of years of your life just cleaning up my mess? I'm a very messy person. I just leave stuff everywhere. Oh, look at this, just terrible. You can spend years of your life cleaning that up for me, right? And so I would spend years and spend all my money, you know, just helping for nothing. Why? Because I was afraid that they might say, but what if they just said, hey, you know what? I lied about that Yogananda sitting here writing this book about, and you know, autobiography of a yogi or something. No, it didn't happen there. It didn't really happen. You weren't on the spot. It didn't happen. It was somewhere else. I kind of, you know, fudged a little bit. And I go, you know, lose my state of religious ecstasy, right? So they have had me trapped. They've had me trapped all these years. Really, this is how it happens. It's, entrapment is just, it's vicious, unbelievably dark. And there are people who are experts at trapping you that way. So what I'm doing for myself and for the world is how to get untrapped from this, how to get free, how to get liberated. And if they say, well, this spot wasn't where it happened. I was mistaken. They wouldn't say they lied. They said, you know what? We just discovered a mistake. And somebody, I don't know who it was, we thought it was here, but we've just discovered it's not here. You know, they won't say they lied about it, but of course they did. They do. They do. Then I just like lose my state of religious ecstasy. I think I'd just be like completely, you know, deflated, crushed. I'd know what to do with my life and everything. So they have that over you. And they start saying, you know, I'm not totally sure. And you go, oh. But well, maybe, oh, there's some trash. Could you help me, you know, could you redo my house for me or something? Okay. Oh, I hope she doesn't find out. She says, you know what, I'm thinking of digging into this. And we're not 100% sure this is the spot that you found the spot. We think you did for sure. You know, I think it's everything fine. But you know, but we want to just. Someone said it might not be, but we want to confirm. We want to confirm it is, and we're doing research, and it's going to confirm it. We're really feeling positive about that. But you know what? My house and yard is such a mess. I just don't have the time to do the research. You know, I just don't have the time. And It's really bothering me because, you know, maybe it's not, but we need to confirm it. It's so important to us, you know? So, I mean, if you could just help me with cleaning up this and this and this, and then I'd be able to spend time on this very, very important research. And you say, oh my God, maybe it's not. Maybe I was fooled. Maybe this, I wasted my life. Oh my God. Okay. Don't worry. I'll take care of everything. I'll clean everything up. I'll make everything look beautiful. And you do the research, and they say, okay, that's great. And then as you're working, they come back and say, you know what, we're making a lot of headway. A lot of headway. We really found out some very positive stuff. I know you'll love to hear it. And we're getting close to nailing it down that, yeah, definitely it is. It's, you know, we're not quite there yet. Oh, there's a few more things. By the way, could you do this and could you do that? Oh, I noticed something up there. Could you clean that? Oh, could you take care of that? Sure. We're almost there. I just need a little more time. Okay. You see how it works? It's exactly how it works. It is just the most horrible thing in the world. How we get used. How the continuity fear makes us fools and we get used through religious emotion to be enslaved. To be enslaved to these people who are so materialistic. Have such an insanely huge continuity fear because they refuse to do any spiritual practice because they're prideful. And therefore they're so afraid to look within that they're obsessed with remaining fixated and attached to external appearances, that they're willing to run this scam on you, to con you, run this scam on you. And there's all sorts of variations of this scam. It's been going on forever. Yeah, one moment. Be right back. Okay. Another way of this is in idolatry, external appearances. We want to be attracted and attached to external appearances. We think that saves us. So you see some person who's wonderful, okay, and you say, oh my gosh, and they say, yeah, I'm here for you. I'm here to save you because I'm so wonderful. And you fall into this religious emotion of attachment, like this is heaven sent, this is God sent, this is it. I'm going to be in love forever. I found the external appearance which will protect me from the continuity fear, right? And then they say, you know what? I'm here for you forever. And you say, okay, great. And then what happens, you see? They said, you know, I'm feeling like a little bit, like, I don't know, some kind of little doubt has entered my mind, you know, about forever and I forever. Because, you know, it's like something just doesn't seem right. You know, this, like, my driveway or my road or my wardrobe, or it doesn't quite fit me right. And I just... You know, I'm just wondering, okay, let me take care of that. Yeah. So the idol strings you along, getting what they want to make them their own sense of beauty, their external appearance to everyone and everything around them looking to them, is saying, this is where it's at. Externals are where it's at. I'm attached to these. And you become enslaved. You become enslaved to this so-called special relationship. All special relationships are with idols. All special relationships are idolatry, actually. They're idolatry. And everybody, you know, uses one another in those situations. Some get, those who are prone to go into states of religious emotion get used by very sharp sharks, cynical sharks, who use them to make their own lives seem to be more comfortable and beautiful so they can remain attached to externals and avoid the continuity issue, right? Avoid waking up from the coma so they can remain and say, hey, this is a great coma I'm in. I'm really in a deep coma and it's so beautiful here. Oh, look, I have somebody, oh, there's something I don't like. Oh, it's scaring me. Oh my gosh, I've got all these spiders in the yard. Oh, hey, You know what? I'm feeling so scared. I'm feeling like maybe you don't like me and I'm about to leave you because all those spiders are scaring me. And, oh, you'll take care of the spiders? Oh, how wonderful. Oh, you're so wonderful. And then so you're dealing with all, you know, all these spiders and then you, all this decaying stuff and you spend your life like a garbage person, you know, just dealing with all the nastiness of, oh yeah, no, it's a con game. It's a con game. So this spell has to, we have to come out, wake up from the spell, break the spell for sure. So these spiritual practices are how we're looking to break the spell. We're not looking to denigrate beauty. Okay, this background is very lovely. I took care of it all myself. I didn't have somebody else do it, anything of this situation here. All myself salvaged some things from here and there and set it up. So, you know, I'm not getting people to make my life really super beautiful. But I'm also not trying to, you know, make it ugly either. I'm not trying to just say there's nothing wrong with some loveliness, some beauty. We're not saying that. We're pointing out something way, way more important is how we enslave one another to this, to an obsession, never-ending obsession, because of the refusal to admit we have a continuity problem. Once we admit that we have a continuity problem, then we begin to do right spiritual practice. Then we begin to break the spell. I got all this stuff for free. Most of the stuff here for free. I salvaged it. People are throwing it away. And I said, oh, thank you, God. Thank you, God. So, but keep it simple. Keep it basic. Keep it simple. Keep it basic. Keep it simple. Keep externals basic. Keep it simple. Focus most of your time on right spiritual practice. Break all these spells. Come out of these spells. Okay. So the practice we're introducing here, and I sure hope this is what works, because I have to break this spell. I've been under a lifelong spell of this spiritual romanticism, and super vulnerable to these very clever people who recognize this. You see, if these people, if they can use you, they will. They can. They're experts in recognizing what your vulnerabilities are, what kind of emotion are you vulnerable to, how to generate that, and then how to make you think that they're the source of it, and they can take it away from you if you're not careful, if you don't do what they want. So it's they're very clever. So we have to be even smarter, not clever, but by the grace of the Holy Spirit, find the right spiritual practice to break the spell once and for all. So first, it's let's say the continuity problem. We have to acknowledge this. Otherwise, we are going to be suckers forever and remain in a state of enslavement, of vulnerability of a slave, working on someone's plantation, working yourself to death. They'll work you to death. Look at the history of slavery on this planet, of those very shrewd manipulators of humanity, right, who wanted everyone to work for them so they could have this opulent palace. Right? They worked everybody to death. They didn't care. They were completely obsessed with, they needed something to remain attached to externally. Oh, look at this marvelous palace. Look at this Taj Mahal. Look at this beautiful grounds. Look at this estate. Look at this vast country that I rule. Look at the, you know, I'm so attached to it. I can't let go of it. You know, this is all those who are have severe continuity problem and they're refusing to recognize it. Very, very sunk in delusion. They have no compunction whatsoever to, they'll utilize a million slaves and work them all to death just so they can have fine silks and furs and ointments and marble and lovely musicians and everything like that, so they can say, oh, look at this, it's so wonderful, I never want to leave this. Because they're absolutely terrified of the continuity problem, the continuity fear, and have no clue as to how to deal with it. So now giving out this, sharing with the world this great truth that this, the continuity fear, in which all our tendencies of delay are rooted in, there's no more excuses for the world. There's no more excuses now, okay? We don't have to succumb to these people, this mindset anymore. We don't have to succumb to this mindset anymore. We don't have to remain spellbound by this mindset anymore. It's finished, it's over, done with, we're done with it. We'll no longer play the fool for this anymore. See, I have a very severe continuity problem, the exact same severe continuity problem that everybody has. Everybody has only one problem, and it's an extremely severe problem. I'm recognizing my problem, I'm working on it, I'm working toward the vision of oneness. If you don't want to do that, it's up to you. It's up to you. But that's what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing. If you want to keep working on trying to make external appearances beautiful, knock yourself out. Go for it. I'm not going to help you with that. I'm working on the vision of oneness. I'm not working on landscaping your yard for you. I'm not working on that anymore, you see? I'm not working on trying to transform your external appearances around you into something lovely so that you can feel that, oh, this is it. Here, this spot, this is it. I can stay here forever. This is what I need. No, that is not resolving the continuity problem. The continuity problem is resolved by seeing the light of God, the lovely, beautiful, living light of God, as it overlays everything, as it bathes everything, this clear, smooth, non-intense, non-harsh, shining, just soft, gentle, clear light of loveliness that makes everything look exquisitely beautiful, everything without exception. That's the only way to solve the continuity problem. Nothing else solves it. You can build 1,000 Taj Mahals and it won't do anything to solve the problem. You can build 1,000 great pyramids. It won't do anything to resolve the continuity problem. You can have 1 trillion slaves, and you can make an entire world, plant an entire world with all the most beautiful flowers and plants, and have 1 trillion slaves working every day, maintaining everything, so there's luxurious flowing water and hanging gardens and a Babylon, turn the whole world into Babylon. It will do nothing to resolve the continuity problem. Total waste of time. So that's why Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. I mean, let those who are trying to make death attractive, let them try to make death attractive. It's not for you to do. It's not your job. It's not your job. Your job is to accept the vision of oneness for yourself. That's your job. That's my job. It's your job. So, any place you are, let's say you come into the most lovely garden you've ever seen, you'd say, ah, wow, this lovely place, along with everywhere, this place, along with every place there is so totally bathed in God's lovely living light of remembrance. Wow. Yeah, this place and everywhere else too is so awesome. I just love this place and every place. I just love this place and every place. This place and every place is so lovely to me. This place along with every place is so lovely to me. Yeah. Or you meet this beautiful person. Everybody's so into, you know, being so beautiful. Oh, such a beautiful, this person along with every other person is appears so, God's lovely, God's lovely light of remembrance is bathing them and everyone else too at the same time. How awesome is that? That's wonderful. Oh, this place, holy place. Oh, it is so wonderful that this place, this holy place, and every other place there is in the entire universe is totally bathed in God's lovely living light of remembrance. How wonderful is that? And this place and every other place is bathed in this light of remembrance. That's great. That's great. You see, you stay in your right mind then. You stay with the voice of reason. You don't go into religious ecstasy. You don't go to some trance or religious emotion. You don't swoon. You're not hypnotized. You're not manipulatable. You're not vulnerable to having them take away that specialness. Remember? So one of the key practices we have here to start out with, say, this moment as it is totally free of all specialness. This place, as it is totally free of all specialness. Thank you, God, thank you, Holy Spirit. Ah, this place as it is, how wonderful, it's totally free of all specialness. It has the equal, it has, oh, the God's light of loveliness is resting upon this too, along with every other place, how nice. How wonderful, of course. Thank you, Holy Spirit. This day as it is totally free of all specialness. This place as it is totally free of all specialness. This person as it is totally free of all specialness. This thing as it is totally free of all specialness. This thing along with every other thing is totally free of all specialness. How great is that? Oh, this place? Ah, this place along with every other place is totally free of all specialness. Wonderful, wonderful. You see how that keeps you centered in everywhereness, right? Keeps you centered in oneness. You don't fall for the trick of specialness. And then someone threatening to take that specialness away from you, and then getting you to be enslaved to work to try to beautify their surroundings, their life, take care of all the problems that they have, you see? So this is integral to what we do here, is these practices enable us to break the spell, the essential spells that we're under, which keep us enslaved, and we need to break those spells right now, because what's coming up in the world very soon is really going to be quite something, and we need this technique to deal with this. And I'll be here, hopefully I'll be here, who knows where I'll be, but wherever I am, that place too will be totally free of all specialness, along with everywhere else. That place too, along with everywhere else, is, as it is bathed in God's lovely living light of remembrance. God's lovely light of living remembrance, it rests upon that place along with all other places, for sure. How could it be any otherwise? Okay, very great. I'll get this one up so we can get going on breaking the spell really quickly. We need to do it really quickly. We need to practice this very quickly before certain events coming up in the world happen. It's very important, and we will do it. All right, that's it.